past 30 years, I visited 50, 60 countries, crisis, conflicts, pandemics, tsunamis, earthquakes. I see it as my job as a photographer to make images that you can relate to these people, because images are the bridge between cultures and misunderstandings, and it's extremely powerful because it's a visual language. It's a language everybody can understand. I feel like giving voice to people who are not being heard. And as long as I have that feeling, I feel I'm literally in the right place. During suffering and during war, also a lot of good things happen. And I give you an example, something I saw during the tsunami in Indonesia, where I was there quite early and made a journey by foot to a small village called Lupung. And that village had 1,200 people, except 30 men who were at work. Everybody died. The only thing they still possessed was a wallet with the money that was in it and a key to the house, but there was no more house and there was no more door. And there was one guy, an older guy. He went to town, took a loan from friends and people he knew, and he just started a store there. And 6 months later, I came back. He was also married to a woman who also lost everybody. And weird as it seems, in all this destruction and all this sheer sadness, there is the ability to bounce back. And I never understood how we do it as human beings. I never got it. And there I found an answer, because I saw it. I see that it can be done. So no matter what we go through, we can bounce back. And that's truly, really amazing. A lot of these stories go into the drawer. We never see and we never hear. And that's where I felt the need to start making books. Like in Iraq, one of the assignments I never got, I worked there for Newsweek and Stern, but the one story I was not allowed to make was more or less the suffering of the Iraqi people.
I had to leave Iraq because Baghdad gives you three options: suicide, be a thief, or be a killer. And I don't want to be a thief, I don't want to be a killer, and I want to make a suicide, you know? So I want a better life, because I feel I deserve it. Yeah, yeah. And I think Western people, they don't actually believe that we are really human beings. I don't mean all the whole Western people. I mean those who don't know us. They don't know what we have been through. So they don't think we deserve a better life.
At the beginning, people were cheering to the Americans, who the many Iraqis saw them as liberators. And if you've been at these mass graves and you see that these liberators enabled that the Shia could now finally bring their loved ones home and give them a proper burial, it makes you wonder why all this hatred against the Americans? What happened there in these months that came after that? And I think that's where my book is about. And this is also why the title of the book is so significant. The title is ʻWhy, Mr. ʻWhy? And I saw it written at a toilet on the base in Samarra, and I saw how American soldiers used this phrase as a taunt. Like one soldier asked the American for cigarettes, and then the other smiled and said, ʻWhy, Mr. ʻWhy? But this was obviously a very serious thing. The Iraqi asked the American soldiers while they were raiding their house, for example, or were passing by even, ʻWhy, Mr. ʻWhy? And I thought that it was the perfect title for this book, because that's what you wonder. If you've been there so long, why? And it's difficult to comprehend, isn't it? there's a filmic rhythm in my work. My work is not about the one, only this one iconic image. To understand such an image, I think you need a wider story. You need to know much more. What happened before, what happened after. So this whole idea of Cartier-Bresson about the decisive moment, it's my business, but I'm not all about it, so to speak. And so I collected, I think, 10 or 16, I can't remember, stories that were really significant, like this one, the United Nations headquarters in Baghdad was bombed. And this was the day that all the NGOs left Iraq, and also the United Nations left Iraq. Very significant moment. So I tried to blend in and I tried to be invisible. And the moment I photograph, what I always see is that people just keep doing what they are doing. I always feel like in war there is a certain code or some agreement with people, like, when you photograph them, like, okay, now you can be our voice, go ahead. At least somebody is listening now through this image. So I came back from Iraq after 10 months and I had the pictures, I had the title, but now how to make a book out of it. My designers, Linda van Dursen and Armand Mavis, saw all the work I did and they understood I photograph and I think it's more like a filmmaker. So they really wanted to make this book thick. So we decided many pictures. Linda and Aman has tested all the papers in there. What would be the thinnest paper that didn't shine through? They kept the outside of the paper cut like newspapers from, like newspapers are, expressing more or less the immediacy of and the urgentness of the story. And later it won awards and became popular, etc. So I was invited to make exhibitions as well. When it was 2005, 2006, I really wanted to know what was going on there. And now there were millions of refugees from Iraq. People were leaving. And I understood that it's now impossible to travel through Iraq. And so I found a new way of getting that report out of Iraq. And I thought, let's start with the refugees. Let's ask them, why did you leave? I published ʻBaghdad, Callingʼ a few years before the Arab Spring, before the mobile phone became so important and civilians started to use the phone as a media tool. People were telling me all the time the same stories, but I didn't have pictures. One night, I visited an apartment of five Iraqi doctors who left the country. And then one of the doctors took out of his pocket his mobile phone and he said, okay, and this is our friend just before he died. And I looked at that photograph and I was like, wow, this is so powerful, this is so meaningful. These are the images I'm looking for. It was highly controversial when I published ʻBaghdad, Callingʼ, I can tell you that. The photojournalism world really thought like I came berserk, you know. But actually it was storytelling again. It was about telling a story. When I made these projects in Iraq and after I've seen a lot of devastation, it makes you wonder who we are. Belief is not something religious, it can be found in secular, contemporary life. The way we are using our phones, the way we read our Quran or our Bible. Belief is about a higher power telling you what is good and what is bad for you. Something really big change in mankind, and we decided to think by ourselves. And with the artificial intelligence in the digital age, it seems like we make a U-turn there again, because it's not me who decides who I want to vote for or what I want to eat. No, it's this artificial intelligence that comes from gathering data. Life is unpredictable. If there's one thing I've learned over all these years, life is truly, totally unpredictable. And we better take care of each other. I think that's the most important message. We have to take care of each other, because today you are the refugee, but tomorrow I can be the refugee. Today you are the victim, and maybe I'm the perpetrator tomorrow. This is how unpredictable life is. It's unbelievable. It can flip like that. So to see and feel humanity, I think that's the essence we have in life.